In the spotlight today, Miltonia Sunset. Well, not quite. Milmetonia Sunset. Regardless of the name change, Milmetonia is accepted by the RHS. This hybrid is so popular, so we have a lot of channels joining in on this care collab. Thank you so much for coming by and watching my video, for taking the time to see how I grow mine here in southern Spain. And thank you so very, very much to all the channels that are jumping on this care collab. There's going to be a lot of variety, a lot of different setups. If you are in doubt with regards to how I grow mine, links will be in the description below of all the channels participating today. And I'm sure that there will be methods and certain nuggets of information that might confirm that you're doing the right thing with your Miltonia Sunset, or if you're contemplating buying a Miltonia Sunset, then possibly all the different variations of setups will help you make a calculated decision to grow the one that you are going to be buying with success. Yes, it is a very windy day. For that reason, I have a lot of pictures so that the bloom can always be appreciated, because my goodness, that is a beautiful little bloom. Personally, I have not had a lot of experience with Miltonia Sunset. Let me correct that. Milmetonia Sunset. I gotta get used to that. I have not had a lot of experience with mine. She is just a recent acquisition from this year in 2021. I finally bit the bullet and I did get myself one from the garden center. And it was like a rescue, semi-rescue. I would say if you get a rescue Milmetonia Sunset, then that is already pretty, pretty drastic. In the recent months that I've had her, all I can say is she is vigorous. So to get a rescue Milmetonia Sunset, I am sure that rescuing it will be successful, because even my little rescue here looked a little bit shabby to begin with, but goodness me, she has bounced back and with a vengeance. To have the situation now and have her in bloom again, two blooms to begin with, we'll work on that in the coming years. That is pretty remarkable in such a short period of time. When I got her, this growth was only just starting. It has matured, it is chucking out roots, and it's blooming. What is not to like? End of story. Thank you for watching. There's a little bit more to that though, so thank you for staying on and listening to how I care for mine. I have potted mine up in pumice, and the entire setup is self-watering. The pumice for me is wonderful because it has such high water retention. The orchid has very fine roots. I need a lot of humidity around the surface of my pots because I live in a very, very dry climate. I only have an average humidity of about 30% throughout the year. Especially in the warmer months of the year, it can drop to 10. I have hot, dry winds, so this is why I chose this setup with very high water retention. I can flush easily, the oxygen exchange stays stable throughout the pot, and the roots themselves can go into all the nooks and crevices that pumice provides. If I had potted her up in small lecker, I would have had to be much more vigorous and aggressive with spraying the top of the media, and I don't want to do that at this stage. The orchid was not vigorous enough when I bought her for me to go in there and possibly risk the one new growth that it was growing, which was its future. Turned out really, really well. I still flush this orchid a lot, as if she was still new in the pot. You can see that despite my best efforts, I've got some root tip dieback there, but I do always take in consideration that I might have 20% collateral damage when it comes to roots growing, as long as the majority of them grow into the pot. The orchid did have viable roots when I got her. However, that was in bark, and when you change media, the old roots might have failed. So I'm not banking on what's in the pot. I'm working with what I'm seeing coming out now. Little bit of collateral damage, not so bad. I've got more going in the pot than I have dieback. I have been very conservative on the fertilizer front. As you can see, she didn't seem to care. I still got two blooms. And you can also see that the bulb that she grew since she's been in my care is the same size as the previous bulb. So there's only onward and upward for this one. Very, very conservative with the fertilizer just because of the roots. What I've been doing is applying 160 parts per million because of the fine roots, because she isn't established in the pot and the mass of the orchid isn't that big that it would warrant higher fertilizer than that. And only recently have I applied that amount of fertilizer. I was mainly focusing on getting strength into the orchid, getting the growth hormones activated and supported. So I've been using a lot of seaweed and I've been using a lot of calcium and magnesium. And when I say a lot, I mean often, but not a lot in quantity. So I have a total of 100 parts per million in the pot, but 40 of those are seaweed and 60 of those parts per million are calcium and magnesium. But with the frequency of how often I refresh the reservoir, that is what I mean when I say a lot. The amount of light I give this orchid, she is under my watch, so I don't lose sight of her. Flushing is very regular, but that is why she is in the south-facing part of my blooming alley. She is on the top shelf, so she gets quite high light, but is a little bit protected by a white curtain. As the sun is moving across the sky, sometimes she gets direct sun. Not quite sure if that is the reason for the spotting here, but it doesn't look to be harming the leaves themselves, the newer leaves. So there is a time period during the day that she does get direct sun. She is a little bit more of an intermediate to cool grower. She doesn't have as low variables as a Miltoniopsis, for example. So her parents also have warm growers in them. Miltonia flavescens, Miltonia cloesii, Miltonia regnellii, and a very cool grower in this parentage is Miltoniopsis vexillaria. So this orchid in my climate, where I can have temperatures of 40 degrees in the summer, it's going to be okay because it has been bred to be a little bit more intermediate tolerant side of temperatures. What I'm going to do with her this winter, seeing as it is my first winter, I'm going to leave her outside for as long as possible. My winter temperatures can drop down to 5 degrees Celsius. That is always a little bit too cold for me, but some orchids can actually tolerate that. And this one, I'm going to test how low can I go with this one during the winter. I would have space for her indoors, where she would then be living under shop lights in my dining room to supplement a little bit hours of daylight. But I want to test how far can I push this orchid with regards to cold temperatures. Doesn't mean I want to kill my orchid, it's just a test. Here in Europe, I can always replace her. That is not the plan. Please do not misunderstand me that it's not a precious orchid that I want to just risk and possibly lose. That's not the point. But it is interesting for me to see how many orchids can I keep outdoors that can handle the colder temperatures for the winter so that I don't run out of space for the 3 months where I have to bring my orchids inside. My winter temperatures can go as low as 17 degrees Celsius, 15 degrees Celsius during the day, but the south-facing blooming alley where she lives is always a tad warmer because we get a lot of sun also in our winters, and that just warms the air up that much more. Of course, if it gets dull, dreary, and a continuous cold snap of a week or 10 days, and if I get nervous, then I will bring her in. But the plan for my orchid here for the future is to leave her outside, let her enjoy the fresh air, because that is exactly what they love, a lot of air movement. So on a windy day like this, it is perfect for her, not so much for me. I hope the mic is protected enough. I have not had any pest issues with her whatsoever. If she becomes as vigorous as her reputation precedes her, then I'm going to probably be pretty cross with myself that I haven't had this cross for longer. So for my limited time with this orchid, I find her absolutely remarkable. I still don't have a fragrance. I find her easy to grow. She wants to grow. Love me orchids that just want to grow and perform. And I'm hoping to see something else happening very, very soon, because I have a little growth point right here. There's a little nubbin starting. Now that's been there for quite some time. It hasn't moved, but as long as an orchid is in bloom, there's not really much happening on the growth front. And I'm assuming that this one will start with that new growth once the blooms drop. Bloom duration, to my understanding, is about 2.5 to 3 weeks. The cooler temperatures obviously will extend that bloom duration. And I'm not sure personally if I like the way the petals and sepals curl back like that, looking like a claw. I prefer my blooms to be flat, open, upright. So I'm going to be very interested to see the other videos. Check out the other blooms on those videos to see if there are Milmetonias that have a beautiful spread out, flat petals and sepals structure. because that looks so much prettier as opposed to this. My opinion only. If you have any questions with regards to the pumice, the properties, I have a video about my media, and that is explained more in depth in that video. If it's something that I can answer very quickly, leave me your questions in the comments below. And once again, if you're in doubt about what I'm doing here and would like to have more options, all the channels that participated in this care collab are linked in my description below. And that is a binge watch on Milmetonia Sunset. And I hope that you do enjoy watching those videos. I appreciate your time. Once again, thank you so much for being here on my channel, watching my video. And I hope to see you again in the next video. In the meantime, have yourselves a wonderful, wonderful day. Please stay safe and take care. Bye.